from the word go till the end. That is what he is a reflection. A judge has to maintain that, and I don't know how he maintained in spite of all lawyers pouncing, shouting, but he kept his cool and passed the order which he thought was correct and the need of the hour. We are grateful to you, sir, for your humility, self-restraint, and kind words both inside and outside the court. Just a brief resume, was born in 1951, and he did his BCom, an LLM, and was also a chartered accountant. He was recipient of National Scholarship for LLM Studies. He was enrolled as an advocate on 25-7-1976, and was a solicitor and also an additional government pleader of Gujarat in Gujarat High Court from April 1986 to August 1994. And he conducted matters and appeared for several statutory authorities, including Public Service Commission, Gujarat Public Service Commission, and Panchayats, and many others. He was a part-time lecturer from 1976 to 1995 in L.A. Shaw College and continued for nearly 19 years. And immediately thereafter, he taught LLM students. Immediately thereafter, he was elevated to the bench on 18-9-1995 as an additional judge and later became a permanent judge on 18-6-1997. He was appointed as the Chief Justice of Andhra High Court and assumed charge on 7-1-2008. He was a patron and chairman of the Advisory Council of the International Center for Alternative Dispute Resolution. He was a chancellor for NALSA University of Law, Hyderabad, and he assumed the office of the Chief Justice of Bombay High Court on 11-2-2010, and finally elevated as a judge of the Supreme Court of India on 30-4-2010, and till date, he conducted himself in such a graceful manner that we all, I on behalf of the Bar Executive Committee and all the members, thank you for your temperament, sir, and you maintained that till the end of the matter. Finally, I must say, Mrs. Tave must have been very lucky to have him because of his temperament. And I hope he maintains even that at his residence and home also. I take the pleasure of thanking the learned solicitor and all others, law officers, the learned secretary general to be present here, and greeting him on this occasion. We pray for a happy, peaceful, and contented life hereinafter, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And I must add to what Mr. Ajit Sinha said, that even Honorable Justice Dave is also very lucky to have a graceful lady like Mrs. Dave. I hope the bar agrees with that. With those words, may I request Mr. Mukul Rohtgi, the Attorney General for India, to come and say a few words.
Good evening, everybody. Chief Justice on the dais, Justice Dave, Mr. Bhatia, Mr. Sinha, judges of the Supreme Court, retired judges, senior and junior lawyers, friends. I think the wheels of time have had two surgical strikes. One exactly a week ago, last Friday, when Justice Shivkirti Singh retired, and one today when Justice Dave, the senior most puny judge, retires today. 6 years have gone by when Justice Dave came to this court, and the inexorable movement of time has brought this day for all of us today. I wish him well. I wish his wife, Meena ji, his two sons, they will have more of him now. His son, Nachiketa, I used to meet every day, virtually every week he was here for some case or the other. So I told him and Justice Dave that you should remain in Delhi, you will remain active. we require judges, arbitrators who have compassion. Compassion and practicality, I think, is more important than mere academic knowledge of the law. Justice Dave, I found I appeared in innumerable cases in the last 6 years, must be maybe more than 100. I found that he had an uncanny vision of trying to find a practical solution to finish off the case, try and keep both sides happy, finish it off one way or the other. I think this trait comes from the trait of his home state. That is what people say, and I think it is absolutely true. I would like to share just two cases in which I appeared, not for the importance of those cases, but for the reaction of the judge, his compassion and patience. In one case, scores of police officers from a state who had served more than 10 to 15 years were suddenly thrown out of service on the ground that they had used an unfair means in the exam. So these people came to me after the judgment had been delivered and they had been unseated after 10, 15, 20 years. And their crime was that somebody had underlined the heading of a question, somebody had used pencil, somebody had put something in bold letters, the heading. So I said, and I'm now sharing a secret, I said, if we file a review, we all know what happens to a review generally, because we will not be heard. So I went and mentioned it to him, that if you were to write Anil on a question paper, then certainly it's an unfair means because you are disclosing. But if you were to merely underline, would you disqualify somebody? The judge's heart was full of compassion. He said, well, no. I said, you have done it in this judgment, so kindly rehear it. So the matter was heard again. The judgment was recalled and we succeeded. So all those people were put back. The second instance I remember, after the NEET order, there was a lot of confusion in the NEET proceedings in May before the court was closing. So the government passed an ordinance. It was heard in June or July or something. So my clients were very worried. The ordinance is now used to kind of remove the basis of an order passed by such and such judge, and the petition is also coming before such and such judge. So what will happen? So I told them, the judge will take no affront because it is an order of a court, not of an individual, and the legality of your case will be tested. So that's exactly what happened. There was no affront, there was no anger. The case was heard and decided, and yet to be decided actually, in the same manner in which it was any ordinary case, and not as if we were trying to upturn an order of a particular judge. I came to know Justice Dave and Mrs. Dave very closely because we have been on two overseas trips together. One was the trip last year in Australia, when the Chief Justice was there, Justice Dattu was there. And recently, in a trip to Korea and Japan, which was led by Justice Thakur, the Chief Justice of India. Justice Dave has no airs. He doesn't behave like a lot of other people do, of holding a very high constitutional position. He would mix with everybody, junior or senior, and was always cheerful. And the Chief Justice will vouch for the fact that whichever city we would go, Justice Dave would like to see the city from end to end, from 7:30 in the morning till 8 p.m. at night, with his camera hung on his neck. So one last secret I want to let you in, and that is that the Chief Justice does not refer to Justice Dave as Justice Dave. He calls him Panditji. Thank you very much. I wish his family a very glorious future, and same to Justice Dave. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mukul, sir. Very insightful secrets have been shared with the bar, and I am sure the bar is very happy to know these secrets, sir. May I request Honorable the Chief Justice of India, Justice T.S. Thakur, to kindly come and address the audience, please. Can we have a round of applause, please?
My esteemed brother Justice Dave, worthy Attorney General, Mr. Bhatia, Mr. Sinha, my brother judges, senior advocates, members of the bar, ladies and gentlemen. I have known Justice Dave for almost 17 or 18 years. I don't know how many of you know, but our first meeting was at a high altitude, at 17,500 feet, with snow all around, at a place called Sangla in Ladakh. It so happened that I was on my way to a place called Pengong So, which is a lake 140 kilometers long and about 40 kilometers wide. Half of it is in China and half in India. It's a place which is worth visiting, and I'd heard a lot about it. But when you go there, you have to cross over this high altitude pass of Sangla, where the most essential thing for survival, namely oxygen, is very, very rare. So by the time we crossed over to the other side of Sangla, two of my companion members of the team, my younger son and my younger brother, they were struck by pulmonary edema, which is the complication arising out of lack of oxygen. So while we were about 50 kilometers short of Pengong So, I thought that taking them any further would be dangerous to their lives, so we decided to stay for the night at a place called Tangse. It was a army kind of a camp where we spent the night. And morning, the first thing I did was I packed these two people with pulmonary edema, you see, gasping for breath without oxygen, and wanted to rush them to lay so that they could be given oxygen and they could be put in a pressurized chamber. So while we were again going up Sangla, because we have to cross Sangla to the other side for lay, I noticed that a jeep is coming from a distance, and I thought that since army was coordinating our trip, army people have realized that two persons are very critical, so they must have sent some rescue team, some doctor, some oxygen for my patients. And here the jeep comes and stops in front of my vehicle, and a tall, handsome man turns out and asks me, "Are you Justice Thakur?" I said, "Very much. Are you some doctor?" He said, "No, no, I am Justice Dave." I told him, "Brother, where are you going?" That was the first meeting I had. I said, "Where are you going?" He said, "I am going to Pengong So." I said, "Don't go there. Look at the condition of my patients behind. They are, you see, grasping for breath. And my advice to you is, you also return with me. It is not worthwhile because it's very dangerous." Then he started a long lecture. He said, "No, no, I have been here for 15 days. I have traveled to Zanskar, this, that and the other." I realized that he has traveled all over, and he would not give me way because his vehicle was parked in front of me and I wanted to somehow leave the place. So I told him, brother, please, you carry on with your trip, but let me pass because my patients will die at Sangla if you don't let me go. It was such an interesting meeting. I have narrated this many times to him, reminded him of our first meeting, which was in very cold climate, but thereafter we had very, very warm relationship with each other for the past 18 years or so. He is a great trekker. By his own estimate, he has trekked in Himalayas for about 4,000 kilometers. So wherever we asked them, why were you trekking so much in Himalayas, he would say, have you seen that old movie, Himalaya Ki Gaud Mein? I said, yes, that was that beautiful movie which had a very beautiful song, Chand Si Mehbooba Ho Meri Jab Aisa Maine Socha Tha. That movie had that song.